So the talk is quite straightforward, actually, and we don't have a lot of time, because it's a very good show. I don't think I'm going to be able to linger as much as the forward in the handout on some of the aspects that relate to my practice a little more. So although I will probably allude to some of this kind of holographic theory or David Bohm, it's going to be within the sort of body of the text. I'm not going to make reference to it. But I quickly wrote a kind of subtitle, and that's Anapsis, Elliptical Impressions of Emergent Technologies Embedded into an Exhibition. Anapsis is a point of least or greatest distance of a body in an elliptical orbit about a larger body. Perhaps the title should read Apsis ad infinitum, as what I would like to allude to or propose is a multiplicity of eccentric orbits and trajectories aggregated into a kind of interference field or evolving climate. This is an image of the Voyager orbits. But hopefully this talk will come back around again instead of going off into outer space. I recently co-curated a group exhibition in Kunsthall Bergen in Norway, titled Noing Uv It. The title is a quote in a fictitious dialect taken from Russell Herland's 1979 novel Woodley Walker. The show is in two parts, the second entitled The Showing of It, which focuses on the work of Simon Lean, which I've been taking part in. So this is a side of Russell Herland's Woodley Walker. The reasons for referencing this book were many. At the outset, we wanted to make a show about objects in the Anthropocene, a show that should avoid the pitfalls as far as possible of curatorial conceit and the fashionability of curated shows, superficially illustrating current trends in philosophy and socio-anthropology. All too often, I think, work in such shows is employed to furnish these conceits, rendering work dispensable outside of its utilized agency in a specific context. So the difficulties in setting forth a show that shares many concerns with fashionable schools of thought, like object-oriented ontology, is problematic. And it's problematic in that it can obfuscate the conflicting intricacies resulting from the far from existing relationship between objective and the anthropocentric. In fact, we wanted to make it clear that the show was in no way an explication of speculative realism. Instead, we wanted to see how the diverse strands of social, linguistic, scientific, philosophical, and aesthetic inquiry that have become so divorced from one another can somehow become enfolded or bound into this discordant phenomenological aggregate, as it were. The book appears to be written in Chaucerian English, but it is in fact set 2,000 years in the future after an apparent nuclear cataclysm, a kind of leveling that allowed the re-emergence of language, rudimentary technologies, and a mythological system rooted in distant memories of particle physics and Christian allegory. In particular, the motif of the vision of St. Eustace, a tiny apparition of Christ braced between the stag's antlers and apparently being riven apart. In this arcane future cosmology, the image of the tiny figure is fused with an anthropomorphism of atomic division. Atom was abstracted and personified, becoming Adam, the primal volatile organism, always at odds with itself and trying to render itself apart. In fact, this dualism or strobing between the revealed and the concealed appears throughout the book in various ways, allowing the exhibition to feed off these fertile dichotomies without adhering to the strictures of any specific dogma, hopefully. The exhibition is punctuated with examples of thingly devices that straddle the cusp of art objects or artifact, cunning things perhaps that might parallel or elucidate current occupations and artistic practice, fields of contemporary research that permeate the string zeitgeist. I'm going to use these far from auxiliary examples in emergent technologies and potentized matter to act as satellites performing eccentric orbits around the various facets of the show and the symptomatic relationships in which material, I think, that this engenders. Vast cushions of blue-green algae, vibrantly coloured plots of bacteria and swarms of polychromatic proto-animals existed in all their complex glory, illuminated by photons and cast into penumbra by clouds of silt or the rotation of the Earth, long before anything possessed even the most rudimentary apparatus designed to receive this information. Primitive eyes or light sensors emerged in response to these pre-existing factors, in the same way that other senses developed to respond to heat or toxins. It is also arguable that primitive consciousness developed in a similar way to allow us to better understand the underlying patterns that composed the universe or multiverse, and that's actually kind of linked to what I was going to say about David Bohm. This trilobite specimen from the Natural History Museum in Oslo possesses one of the first sophisticated compound eyes, consisting of an array of lenses uniquely forming crystalline calcite. It is the only animal ever to have metabolized minerals in this way, enabling trilobites to become the most successful group of animals ever to have existed, totally monopolizing life on Earth for many millions of years. This example is around 400 million years old, and other species exist with exaggerated adaptations that allowed them to thrive in a plethora of different habitats. Recent developments in drone technology have come to astoundingly similar solutions in the manufacture of these ultra-sensitive robotic eyes. These artificial eyes perform in precisely the same way as the example from the fossil record. This conjuncture of atavistic biotechnology that re-emerges at the heart of the military-industrial complex collapses time as linear, and dimension becomes materialized and commodified, rendering time a kind of valorized background culture like agar in a petri dish. This is a Mark Lecky piece made for ladies and the trilobite as a kind of healer. Yes, another new but ubiquitous technology is the coloured light emitting diode. The LED is well known, but development of a coloured LED that could display RGB was only achieved recently by a Japanese team who won a Nobel Prize for their efforts. The technology has been rapidly deployed in a host of applications and is employed here in the service of recent work by Mark Lecky called Transformer RGB in 2012. The loop is, work is a looped piece of appropriated Disney footage that depicts the transformation of the puppet Pinocchio into an ass. Here, an equivalence is arrested between a light emitting array and a light receiving array that mutually employ the same means opposing ends. This arrested equivalence is again emphasized in the adjacent work by Wolfgang Tillmans, Headlight 2012. The headlight of the car bears an uncanny resemblance to the eye of the extinct creature, and it's second nature to make these kind of direct relationships. A shortcut, I think, in categorizing and subjectifying discrete objects into cursory relational codecs that reflects a hardwired predisposition in us to create a connectivity, even if it is spurious or fugitive. This is an image of the exhibition. There was 40 artists in many works, which I didn't even know what counts. That's how you start back to Jung. The associative taxonomic bias is endemic in the way in which we codify and index objects and ideas. To this end, it was important to incorporate and address written and oral aspects especially in instances when the written word transcends utilitarian agency. A kind of reverse etymology occurs when a word is projected into the world and is held there. This holding open of the open is the scinted tributary, if you like, of the linguistic term, at once rendering the word from the flow of social agency and simultaneously concreting it into the realm of sovereign materiality. The whole show, in fact, can at times resemble a kind of concrete, roving poem, full of thorny syntax and flashing object grammar. I've always been interested in the autonomous nature of objects and the events, experiments in artificial intelligence and in particular sort of early computer poetry. IBM's AB program from 1962, AB stands for auto-beatnik, represents the first serious attempts to generate, or some of the first serious attempts to generate such material. I came across these in a contemporary article in Time magazine in the 1990s, and I was about to play some audio, and contributed them to an early volume of the journal Inventory. They're fragmentary and concentrated, and when I first encountered them, they came as a total revelation. Everything I would expect from the jolt of consciousness associated with an original encounter. In short, proper art. So now I'm going to play Stakes, Courses, and Roses by Otto Beaming. Mouse isn't.
Roses, few fingers go like narrow laughs, an ear won't keep few fishes. Who is that rose in that blind house? And all slim, gracious, blind planes are coming. They cry badly along a rose. To leap is stuffy, to crawl was tender. Corsets, yes, illiterate is its rowdy, black is his avenue. Mine is a hay of these dwarfs. Does he look like a sim of alabaster? Moreover, food tastes like koi buttermilk. States, is that the automaton that smells like the tear of grass? All blows have glue, few toothpicks have wood. Director Button, put I may battle the ham. The crafty carnival's kite daintily massacres the scalp. Yes, we would. You shall. Shall not I tighten a moose's parasite?
So that was included, those three poems were included in that fashion with this this English accented computer voice called Peter in the show. There were various other sound works, but I'll get onto that. This is a slide of prehistoric digital poetry, an archaeology of forms 1959 to 95 by C.T. von Kendall. The allusion to fossilization, activism, and archaeology appears again here. These technologies were seen as an experimental means to an end, with the sophistication of the software improving constantly. Consequently, the surreal automatic mechanical utterances were not seen as having much inherent artistic merit, so no serious archive was kept, unless the programs or poems were engendered or set in motion by the poets. There is scant evidence remaining of the reams of entropic creativity. However, more recently, an exhaustive and valiant attempt to coordinate an academic study of this form was made by Chris Funkhauser in his revealing of the title, An Enlightening Look at Prehistoric Digital Poetry and Archaeology of Forms. This wasn't included, neither of these books were included, but they were going to come to glossary in the catalogue. This is polyglot lexicon Phillips lexicon by Kenneth Bassan, tried to achieve the idioglossia of, the idioglossia of techno-speak phenomena, an attempt to taxonomy of the new lingo of global commerce and mobilized logistics. Paul Seitzema's work, Abstract Composition 2014, exemplifies the bullet point valorization of objects by the lurid and banal descriptions of auction catalogs. This computer-generated work was transferred to and projected in 35mm film. It's this rotating piece of pierced cardboard which came and these different descriptions from the auction catalog. This is Jenny Holzer from the survival series, City Holds and People for Breeding or from Shooting. Jenny Holzer's survival series emerged from a climate of emergency and tension. The late 70s were characterized by a swing to the libertarian right, and the threat of global nuclear conflagration and even Star Wars blended with the horrors of autoimmune deficiency syndrome, migration extinction, and ecological and financial collapse. These aphorisms and the means of their manifestation and deployment somehow ossify language into discrete pellets that challenge the bounds and comforts of buffet culture and act as epitaphs to the vivid nature of existential survival and the immediate danger bound up with the saccharine serum of global capital and its media vehicle, belching clouds of pruned and shaped subjectivity. The linguistic and technological trickle down from the military industrial complex was fairly rapidly utilized within the arts. And the cybernetic serendipity shown on the ICA included many co-opted technological revelations, including much computer-generated poetry, music, and other forms of artificial intelligence. Sound design and the deployment of mathematical formula and algorithms continue to play a considerable part in contemporary art. Florian Hecker's Stocker Acid Vluke, 2011, Kerrith and Evans' Sound Focusing Spotlight, Transference, Frequency Shifting Paradigms in Streaming Audio, 2009, are examples of the agency of such technologies included in the Noing Uv It. Sound focusing technology was adopted in the post-war era as a potential sonic weapon, but has only now been properly developed with direct consequences for surveillance and advertising. This is sound activated module by Edward and Nathalie in a torch. Okay. So Edward and Nathalie was an artist and robotics engineer born in Poland. He moved to the UK where he lectured in robotics at Imperial College London. He considered the cybernetic sculptures he made to be art foremost and science almost consequentially. And I'm just going to show some silent or SAM, or Sound Activated Module, was shown in the Cybernetic Serendipity exhibition at the ICA. The components were inspired by natural forms, and he was fascinated by the movement and mechanisms of animals. Indeed, the whole project was catalyzed by a vivid encounter with a caged tiger. Observing and monitoring its behavior and actions to its immediate environment. His later work, Sensor, was a larger, refined, and more refined project based primarily on the mechanism of lobster claw. These analog animals, non-specific mechanical avatars, still evoke the existential animalistic insecurities of the psychological rather than physical ecology. We borrowed Sam from his son Michael, who had it presiding over his living room. It's no longer functioning, reality that it now projects. Along with its, I suppose, its exhausted identity. So I was just, I'm going to skip something, I think. It is a relic of its own potentiality, defying redundancy or obsolescence, as it was never intended to perform a commercial function. It's dormant, subtly active, conspicuously beautiful wreckage, strangely able to colonize the past and future. This is an image that wasn't in the exhibition of a part of an Ariane rocket that found its way into the Amazon River and was pulled out by some local people, inhabitants. So now we are arguably leaving the Holocene and entering the Anthropocene epoch, described by a geological footprint of artificially fabricated strata, composed of various petrochemical plastics and other detritus and surplus that abound into the makeup of this planet, deposited stealthily on other planetary bodies far off in the vacuum of space. In this environment, the notion of the Anthropocene fossil comes into play. The speed of this process is dependent on various environmental and geological factors that can be accelerated or retarded depending on a variety of agents and factors such as context and ecology. Indeed, the fossilized component of an object could conceivably be built into it at its genesis. So the fossilized component could be built into a thing. John Soane designed his buildings to make attractive ruins. Why not make buildings that could make good fossils? In collaboration with Noing Uv It, the European Space Agency has begun work on the development of techniques that would enable the construction of buildings on the south pole of the moon. Composed of a substance called regolith or lunar dust, the building would be composed of 3D printed buttress walls assembled around a vertical structure. The prohibitive cost of transporting water to the moon and the lack of manpower and sufficient gravity, obviously, means it would prove impossible to produce concrete in a traditional way. The minimum binding material needed for 3D printing and the capacity to build by remote control lends itself to the task of constructing a lunar habitation by this 3D process. The development of this technique was pioneered by Monolite UK, a British company, obviously, again, building large-scale 3D printed sculpture. In collaboration with its partners at ECA, so ESA, European Space Agency, and Pro-Associative, Monolite had permission to produce this 1.5-ton block that found its way overland to a very terrestrial location of Kunsthall Bergen. Substitute for regolith of the moon dust was found in the cauldron of an Italian volcano. It's 98% identical to its dusty lunar cousin. The construction of the material mimics the honeycomb pockets of void found in the structure of bird's bones to make it as light and strong as possible. The resulting object, however, belies its high-tech provenance, resembling the ossified creations recently deceased Swiss artist H.R. Geiger. A symptomatical deformed mimesis, reminiscent of biomechanical fantasy and archaeological ruin, seems to be the product of a cannibalistic kind of logic that borrows from the future and past. It appears at once esoteric, anachronistic, aestheticized, and naturalistic. But this fascinating chimera is spawned from a steely economic pragmatism. The fact that the manufacture of structure at the apex of the military industrial complex can trace its heritage to a sculptural fabricator rather than the war machine is unfortunately a mere novelty. Martin Westwood's extruded ceramic forms echo this improbable means of manufacture. The fossilized coprolites of capital purged from the cloaca of the Anthropocene, and that was supposed to accompany it, describe, which hasn't for some reason found its way into a presentation, unfortunately. So this is the moon walking in front of the mountain. The formal aesthetic synchronicity that resulted from the conjunction of Mount Mulliken's cosmology series and the moon block was typical of the interrelation of haptic reciprocity that auto-enabled itself during the formulation and installation of the show. Similarly, Mulliken's diverse but consistent body of work samples the rigid formality of semiotic language, stitches it to the intricate materiality of his sculptural work, and shrouds the package in the esoterical of his induced trance works, during which he produces automatic diagrams and text under hypnosis. He commenced these very personal cosmology works, during the 1970s, and they continue to evolve. This is very recent. Similarly, again, through the printed block, the moon block is somehow profoundly bound to have Sertel 3D printed and routed objects. These objects are described by Sertel as pre-fossilized. They hold encrypted within them the arrested potency of the global technological and biological agents they depict. The hepatitis C virus encased in electroformed silver, housed in an auto-illuminating shelf, is a harness agent of viral self-perpetuating microsystems. A solid stratified computer hardware can map the flow of information just as the heart processes the blood in the vascular system of the individual. The extracted mercurial flow of global commerce is held in the potentized instability of the essential components, including bitcoins and other right now, so imprisoned in their receptacle, like blood in a blood bank. But throughout the exhibition, despite the complexity of the narrative climate, signifiers, there prevails a sense of contiguous or haptic dialogue, a cryptophasia of automatically constructed language developed in situ by the confederated mass of sovereign matter. This duality or coefficiency of the object, splitting and doubling, the implicate nature of things and their explicate becoming world or revealed state can be traced to the primal complexion of matter itself. The way in which particles reveal themselves is quantum. There is no continual movement. In fact, particles literally disappear and reappear sequentially. This very real disappearance is a scientific mystery. Do they expand to fill space and then reduce? Or do they simply visit other parallel dimensions? The particle, separated by light years from its sister particle, would behave in exactly the same way as its uncoupled sibling if manipulated. In order for physicists to better understand this behavior, it has been suggested that computers are built to think like atoms and remove what is referred to by physicists as monkey logic or anthropocentric perspective based on accumulated knowledge. This is what Heidegger referred to as auto-theological thought, which needs to be dispensed with in order for us to be able to think of the being of beings. So here science and philosophy have encountered similar problems. How do we move into a new phase of understanding? And we detach ourselves from what we know in order to uncover the natural order of things on their own terms. Perhaps this is similar to the leveling moment I referred to earlier in the Billy Walker book. The cataclysmic moment after the atom was revealed, or the atom was revealed, its devastating secrets, and the little shining man has gone back to his concealed state. I'm going to leave you with a kind of hubris, perhaps the apex of anthropomorphism. In the 1980s, scientists working on a tunneling electron microscope, which was developed to photograph atoms, found that their subject matter had a habit of jumping onto the lens. The task of removing these atoms so that they might continue their work was Since then, researchers at IBM have discovered reliable, systematic ways of dislodging and reordering atoms, and they believe that nanoconstruction of this sort will eventually enable us to grow objects on an atomic level. So that we might produce something like a stratospheric gliding diamond-built aircraft clothed in a sheen of radiation reflecting gold, perverting things. In the shorter term, they hope to be able to store huge amounts of data using this, the tiniest technologies. In order to display their prowess in this field, IBM have made an animation, which I'm about to show you, titled Boyan's Atom. Coincidentally, the character in the animation was Cousin Adam, in total ignorance of the atomic atom in Russell Hoban's Rhythm Walker. I'd also like to say that, in a way, our orbit has come back around from the first piece that was shown in IBM computer poetry, back around to this IBM animation. They were kind enough to allow me to re-edit the footage, and also they provided me with the sounds of atoms actually being moved, because their little advertising film had a kind of revolting soundtrack on it. So I put this sound of actual atoms being moved around, which sounds like a kind of science fiction soundtrack from the 70s. In fact, the whole film is something of an anachronism. It seems like it was made in the 60s, in actual fact. It's cutting edge technology, but I'll play it for you. Thank you.
have some time for questions. Thank you, Steve, for a very rich and thought-provoking talk. Okay, well, do we have other questions? I was quite interested within the show, Steve, that you were you made quite an effort to talk about the inclusion of a text work within what we might call text work within a framework which was ostensibly addressing a certain fashionable philosophical position, as you put it. I'm quite interested in what you might. What more you might have to say about what that was contributing to that, or what that was redressing in you feel is involved in the OOO
I'm afraid I've just got, this has come undone, so I'm going to do a sort of weird way of talking. Yes, well, I mean, a lot of this especially Graham Harman sort of sets up his argument against the linguistic term. And I think there's a lot of people. I mean, first of all, I mean, it's becoming incredibly unfashionable, which I kind of hate the idea of these things being tossed aside. And this is what I was alluding to in this kind of current trend of speed curation, where people like adopt a philosophical idea and then kind of exhaust it, superficially skim over it, and don't properly examine it. Whereas, you know, what was brought up, I suppose, by and what I was concurrently interested in before I even had heard of the term was this kind of this curious dichotomy, this relationship between the Anthropocene and our and the cult and culture, what we grew up on in post-structuralist French philosophy, and then not being satisfied with our relationship with objects in a kind of typical Marxist perspective, and trying to redress that. But for me, it's more of a way of redressing that, rather than swapping out one set of beliefs for another. And so, I'm very keen to try to think about. I mean, I'm sure if you spoke to Graham Harman or one of these people, they would tell you that the words are objects, and I concur with that. But I'm very keen to try to. Shed light on that strobing between a kind of anthropocentric preoccupation with taxonomy and language, linguistics, certainly within people like Luigi Cavalli-Sforza, who I was going to mention, a guy who's very concerned with mapping genetics with language. And it's been, you know, one of my preoccupations as well as thinking about objects. So for me, it naturally comes out. But I think it was time to try to make a show that talked about words as objects, and also that this kind of haptic language that happens between, this kind of reciprocity that happens between objects, if you like, it's kind of cryptophasy that I'm talking about, or idioglossia, these kind of languages that construct themselves between things, you know, whether that's on a kind of very rudimentary chemical level, or the way that I was going to go on to talk about with sort of David Bohm's theories about this encrypted kind of information within things that could be called a kind of primitive consciousness or a way of kind of communicating without subjecting things to. You know, this cultural anthropocentric perspective, but of course we are all what we are, and for me I really wanted to make sure that the linguistics and the way that linguistics can kind of transcend their cultural baggage can be included in this argument. I mean, it's still not particularly clear to me.
Sorry, I can't talk to all of you.
You can't, okay.
architecture in terms of thinking about how the building or the constructed object decomposes in time. And I was thinking about heterotopia, which is the fusion of sort of utopia and dystopia, so sort of in the middle. I was wondering if you know any artists who are also interested in the hedonistic fusion of stitching the old and the new together in order to preserve and conserve the planet for a more responsible form of innovation and conservation of resources.
Did you say, do I know of any other artists?
Yeah, I
think there's probably a lot of people who are interested in that. I don't know anyone who explicitly makes it their work. It's not that I wouldn't know, I'm afraid.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but it's a fascinating realm.
Yeah, I feel like it's on the forefront of sort of technological innovation, especially because by the year 2025, we were in our own lead, copper, zinc, and all of these things. And this is to create solar panels and renewable resources. So, yeah, I'm a problem with this one.
Anyone else?
I think it's a sort of confederation between the person who instigates that thing and then a kind of reciprocity with the thing you're working with, regardless of whether that's a kind of computer program or a bunch of objects or matter. And I think what happens is that you engender an original encounter, and that's what a good art object is, that it can carry on operating outside of the authorial nature of the maker or the instigator, and so that it kind of strobes this kind of this thing between the revealing and the concealing, between the our world and the world, the interior world of objects, and so I think it straddles and actually I suppose in the future we'll start to understand a little bit more about that when science sort of reveals some of those sort of encrypted.
Isn't that encounter though, that intentionality by the artist, isn't that an incredibly anthropocentric thing to do? You're dramatizing.
Yeah, because that's, but that's me, that's in the Anthropocene, me making a thing. No, but I also think that light hitting algae is a kind of creative thing, and a kind of, there's a kind of reciprocity there. And it sounds a bit like animism, but it's more like a kind of secular animism, where I really think that the encounters and the kind of, in a very small way, this kind of haptic reciprocity, this contiguous nature of things, and the way they inhabit the world, is kind of doing that anyway. I think we just force that and exaggerate it to kind of illustrate things that we're interested in within the Anthropocene. So. Yes, there is a dramatization. I think art is. You create a stage and you use props in many respects to shed light on things that are happening anyway.